Hello everyone and welcome to today's webinar on predicting wall hydrodynamic torque using simulation. So let's start by introducing the speakers for today's webinar. So I am Prathamesh and I work as a support engineer in the simulation team. With me here is Praveen, who is the expert speaker for today's webinar, and he works as the technical manager here at the simulation. Before we begin the presentation, let me complete some housekeeping items for you. First of all, we will be recording this webinar and it will be available to you for your future reference in a YouTube channel. And also, in case you have any queries or questions which arise during the course of the presentation, feel free to add it in the chat box. We'll be happy to answer them at the end in the question and answer session. So let me go over the agenda for today's webinar. So we will first start by knowing what are the torques actually in the walls, the hydrodynamic torque, the factors affecting it, and how it is applicable in the actuator sizing. Further, we will look into the how actually the torque is measured in an experimental way. And then we will have an introduction to the autonomous wall CFD app. We will have a live demonstration of the app, and we will also look into some case studies which have been generated using the autonomous wall CFD app. And at the end, we will have a question and answer session. So that's it, and Praveen will take over from now. Praveen?
Yes, thanks Prathamesh for the introduction. Hello everyone. So before starting the main topic of today's webinar, so it's a better idea to spend some time in the context of valves. Valve torque is nothing but the turning effort needed to rotate the valve's closure member. It could be a ball, disc, or plug, depending on the valve type, and to hold that rotating member in position in a particular angle of opening. This extra energy required to rotate and hold it position, that is required because of the resistance it faces. So the resistance, based on the type of resistance, it is classified, the valve torque is classified into two categories majorly. One is the friction based, and the other one is dynamically generated. So friction based is due to the fact that the rotating body comes in contact with the seating, packing, hub, seal. So because of this, the friction based torques gets generated, and then because of fluid flow, then dynamically generated torque. Under this category comes our topic of interest, which is hydrodynamic torque. So the hydrodynamic torque is the turning moment purely due to the fluid forces that is acting on the rotating body. So let's take a case of a concentric butterfly valve. The disc is partially open and the flow is happening from left to right, like upstream to downstream. And when the fluid flow crosses the disc, the leading edge and the trailing edge, the velocity with which it crosses the leading and trailing edges are different, and due to this variation in velocity, there is an unbalanced pressure force acting on both sides of the disc. So this causes a closing torque, and that is where the actuator comes into picture. And here I'm introducing a new term, which is coefficient of hydrodynamic torque, popularly known as CDT. This is nothing but the non-dimensional representation of the dynamic torque itself, which we discussed in the previous slide, and it is calculated using the formula mentioned over here. So it includes dynamic torque itself and the valve diameter and the pressure drop across the valve. So this CDT, when calculated for each angle of opening and plotted across the whole valve operation range, it gives you a typical CDT curve of some butterfly valve would look something like this. So what are the factors that affect CDT? To start with, the valve opening itself. So for each angle of opening, the CDT or the torque will be different, and as it moves from fully closed to fully open, the complete CDT would vary, and that is shown in the right side over here. And the second factor is the valve size. For different valve sizes, the CDT curve nature also differs. For as the size increases, the CDT also increases, and beyond certain valve sizes, the hydrodynamic torque's contribution in the total torque becomes very crucial, and it also depends on the valve type. So for different valve types, the CDT curve look completely different, and based on the design also, it changes a lot. And also it also depends on the pressure loss happening across the valve. The flow direction also plays an important role in designing the CDT curve. For example, the same valve with the flow direction in which, you know, the shaft side faces upstream or the seat side faces upstream with seat side facing downstream. So these two flow directions will provide a different CDT and different torque load on the actuator. So here you might have noticed the CDT value goes from positive to negative, and there is a particular point where it shifts from positive to negative. That is called torque reversal point. And positive value of CDT indicates the flow, fluid flows forces tends to close the valve, and the negative forces, negative CDT value indicates the fluid forces tends to open the valve. One should try to avoid operating your valve in the torque reversal range. So another important factor could be the velocity profile, velocity distribution just upstream of the valve disc. So when you place your valve just downstream of an elbow bend, then there could be a asymmetric velocity distribution just before the valve, and this contributes in deciding the CDT. So extending this point, last point, there are certain situations where you might have to place your control valve at the downstream of a pump or a bend, or in combination of a series of valves. There, what you have to take care is there are recommendations and guidelines provided by the valve manufacturers, or best practices are established. So what they recommend is the orientation of stem, how it should be oriented with the bend. So we'll see these case as a case study at the end of this webinar, and we'll see what impact has created it will create for in the context of CDT. Okay, so now we know what is CDT and what are the factors that affect CDT. So now we'll focus on, you know, why we should be concerned about CDT and why all manufacturers, valve manufacturers, provide this CDT value for their valve design in the data sheet or catalog. So how it helps the end user. So once you have a CDT value from a valve data sheet, then what we can do is we can calculate the hydrodynamic torque based on the operating pressure drop and plot the hydrodynamic torque for the complete range of opening. And then this is hydrodynamic torque. The next thing is we can calculate all the friction torques, seating, bearing, and the packing torques. So once we got all the individual components of this torque, then we just add and subtract to get the total opening torque and the closing torque. The next step is to find something called as MRST, minimum required shaft torque, which is nothing but the finding the maximum of the opening and closing at each valve opening. Yes. So the next step is to multiply this with a safety factor and to obtain actuator sizing torque. And this AST, actuator sizing torque, is you have to compare it directly with the actuator output torque, and the criteria is the minimum margin should be greater than the difference between AST and MRST. So with this criteria, you can perfectly size your actuator and select it. Now we'll move on to, you know, what are the methods to evaluate or to calculate this valve torques, to measure these valve torques. So first I'll explain, the lab test procedure to find out valve torques. So there are certified labs across different parts of the world, different countries, to name a few, Utah Water Research Laboratory and FCRA in India. There are certain certified labs which perform this flow loop test to find out valve performance parameters like CV, AV and CDT. So if I talk particularly about torque, then there are procedures explained in AWWA M9 standards, which says like how to place the strain gauges in the shaft, on the shaft, which connects the actuator and the valve body, and connecting the valve disc actually. Rest of the flow setup is as per ANSI IEC standard, which explains what should be the upstream length and downstream length of the pipes, where should be the pressure trap tappings located upstream and downstream, and how many flow rates should be considered, and the flow rate should not be so low that we fall in the laminar region, and then we should avoid falling in the laminar region, and the flow rate should not be very high such that we should avoid falling in the cavitation zone as well. So for all these flow rates, you have to measure the opening total opening torque and total closing torque, and the average of these two will give you the dynamic torque. Once the dynamic torque is known, then for the measured pressure drops using the pressure tappings, you can calculate the CDT for each angle of opening. So a typical design cycle of a valve with flow loop test is something like this. It all starts with the design requirement, the target CDT or CV value, which is driven by the market need, and that goes to design engineer as a target. And design engineer comes up with an innovative design, valve design, based on his experience and previous design data available. And the design goes for manufacturing, the prototype. Sometimes it is to the actual scale, and sometimes it is scaled down model of the actual size. And then it is shipped to the flow loop test facility, where they perform this standard procedure for flow loop tests, and they submit a report which has the CDT curves and CV curves. So those data will be sent back. And the time taken for this flow loop test facilities to conduct the test and submit the report, it takes a shipment and everything. Considering this, it will take a typical time of 2 weeks or so. Once the report is obtained, then in case the valve design fails to meet the target CDT, then it has to go through the complete process of again manufacturing it, redesigning it, manufacturing it, shipment, and then flow loop test and the report. So this is a very time-taking process. And what are the challenges in doing the experiments? The resource limitations. Not all facilities are equipped with setups which test many large diameter valves, where it is important to obtain the CDT value accurately. And the design changes requires a whole, the following of the complete loop again. So which is again time taking process and cost is involved. So this comes as a limitation for the designer to explore the complete design space to optimize the valve design. And another important limitation is the lab report provides you very limited flow insights. What is happening inside the valve? It just provides you where you have placed your measurement taps, just the one CDT values across the valve. That's it. So what went wrong in this current design? Where should I focus on to improve my valve design to achieve the target CDT? You have no clue. So what are the other alternate methods? The analytical and computational methods. With analytical, yes, definitely the time and cost are considerably reduced, but along with that, you have to compromise on the accuracy as well. But wherein in computational option or computational methods, the accuracy is in comparable with the experimental results, but the time and cost is somewhat reduced. But the main drawback is the skill set required to perform CFD simulations and get accurate results out of it. This comes as a challenge, but let us understand what goes into a conventional CFD approach. Then we will discuss about the solutions for these problems. So a conventional CFD approach starts with the geometry and then the manual process of fluid volume extraction and the meshing and the boundary condition, turbulence model, numerical scheme setup. So everything comes under pre-processing, and then it requires in-house computational facilities to run this CFD simulations to solve NS equation on all of the mesh cells which are generated in the pre-processing stage. And then once the simulation is completed, you have nice contours and like a flow line animations to understand and interpret the results. And also it provides the complete CFD curve, which is of our main interest. If you closely observe, this CAD is created by the design engineer, and all these steps shown here requires a technical expertise, specifically CFD related knowledge, experience and expertise is required. And then the computational part demands in-house HPC setup. And then the post-processing part requires some special understanding to interpret the results and create or coming up with a nice report. So these are the challenges faced in the conventional CFD. As we discussed, it demands for CFD knowledge and expertise, HPC hardware in-house, and the software licensing cost, you know, commercial software installed, and the team should be trained to use the software. So all this conventional CFD approach make it very selectively used by very short, like some short, like small part of community uses this for designing the valve. So what if we completely automate the CFD process and we shift all our local computations to cloud? And then what if we get an auto-generated report, which is easily understandable and readily you can submit it to the end client? It would be nice, right? So with this vision, we have developed Simulation Hub CFD platform, on which you can generate or create, develop cloud-based CFD simulation apps for designers. So from our Simulation Hub CFD platform, one such app is Autonomous Valve CFD, AVC, which is a specialized app for valve CFD simulations. So we call it a virtual flow loop testing because it follows all the standards followed in the flow loop testing, for example, ANSI/ASA 75. So these standards are used to extract the simulations, these conditions, upstream, downstream, pipe, pressure tapping. So everything is maintained in the app. And it provides you with CV, KV and CDT curves along with the complete results for you to analyze and understand where is the scope for improvement in the valve design. So what we use at the background is open foam solver technology for performing CFD simulations, and we are performing it in the Amazon Web Service cloud computing facility. So the app supports a wide range of valves, rotary control, rotary motion, linear motion and isolation valves. So if you take rotary motion, the ball valve, different types of ball valves, butterfly valves and its types. For the linear motion, it is globe valve and the types of globe valves. And if you talk about isolation valve, we support gate, diaphragm, piston. So it covers a wide range of support for valves. And all you need to perform CFD simulations using this app is a device which is connected with a good access to a good internet connection and installed with a web browser. Yes, the whole app runs on the web browser, so you don't need to install separately any app or anything. So we have kept the workflow very very simple and easy, so that the designer, he himself, should be able to perform the simulations. So it starts with the uploading the CAD model, specifying the flow direction, submitting it for simulation, solving it on the cloud, and just get the results, 3D results accessible on the web browser. That's it. So what we need from you as an input, the CAD model, select what are the moving parts and select the upstream and downstream pipe so that the flow direction is specified. So what we do with this inputs, we generate the, we do the CAD cleanup and fluid volume extraction, the mesh generation and the CFD simulations on cloud. What we provide you after this, we provide you the 3D results, which are accessible on the browser, and the quantitative data, which is CV, KV and CDT curves, and the auto-generated PDF report, which you can submit it directly to the end client. Okay, so here is a short summary of what we have seen till now. So a comparison of conventional CFD approach, where you have to rely on the valve designer has to rely on a simulation expert, either in-house team or outsource it to an external software consultant, where they perform the CFD process manually and then limited by the in-house resources available. And with this constraints, the complete CDT curve generation might take the at least 10 days to come up with the complete process, complete results. And on the other hand, if you take simulation of CFD, there is no third party dependent. It's just the designer and your valve design. You yourself will be able to perform the simulations as the process, the CFD process is automated, and it uses the cloud computing facility. So because of these reasons, the results will be available in less than an hour. And of course, the cost is very affordable and very less compared to the conventional approach, which enables you to explore the complete design space. So that's it for now. I'll hand over the session to Prathamesh, and he will walk you through the app workflow using a live demo. Prathamesh, over to you.
Thank you, Praveen, for providing such a insight about the hydrodynamic torque and the coefficient as well. So let's dive down into the demo part. Let me share the screen. Okay, is my screen visible, Praveen?
Yes, Prathamesh, we are good to go.
So this is the homepage of Simulation Hub, and as you can see, there are various apps which we make for designers as well. And our target today is our autonomous source CFD, and you can have some more info about the subscription as well here. So as Praveen mentioned, that all you need is a web browser, a good internet connection, and a device which can browse through that has a browser. So there is no need for any additional installation and licensing as such. Also, the computation part is handled totally in the cloud, so there is no need for any local high power computing devices as well. So to start a simulation, you will have to move to the dashboard. Okay, so the dashboard is the location where all your past and present projects are visible, and you can access them at any moment of the time. So let's start by creating a new simulation. Give a short introduction or name. So select the app in your subscription. Here we will select the autonomous host CFD and give a short description. And I will create the simulation now. It may take some few moments. So as Praveen mentioned, there are four stages through which you can obtain your wall performance coefficient. The first stage was the wall geometry. And now the first part of the wall geometry is adding the CAD model to the platform. So there are two ways through which you can upload the wall CAD geometry. First is uploading through the local computer, and second is through the Amazon S3 storage links. So I'll take the uploading through the local computer. Okay. It may take a moment to upload, and let me tell you more about the wall CAD which I am uploading. It is a DN400 triple offset butterfly wall, and the current file format which the app supports are the .ipt, .igs, .step, and .sat. And also we recommend users to go with the most common format, which is the .step. And also the while uploading the wall CAD geometry, the user must take care that he's not only uploading the wall body but also the pipes as well. This is in line with the flow loop testing actually occurs in practice. So we basically replicate it. It might take a moment to load it. Okay. So the wall is uploaded now. It is being loaded into the app. Okay, so the wall geometry has been uploaded and it is visible in the viewer. The viewer has some basic viewing facilities of viewing the geometry in a better way. So you can see at the bottom you have the navigation, the various tools through which you can have a better visualization. You can also have a snap of the window visible now. So moving ahead, we have to specify some wall details. So these are basically pertaining to the wall geometry itself and the type of simulation properties which you want to set. This is a control wall type and a rotary type of motion. The wall type is a butterfly wall. It is triple eccentric. The wall size is DN400. You can specify the pipe schedule as well, and specify the wall roughness and the pipe roughness as well. For now, I will let the default value be there and click on apply. The wall details are saved successfully. So the first part has been completed, and now moving to the second part is the selection of the moving parts. Okay. In the first, we have to specify the moving parts of the wall. So these are going to be the disc and the shaft. So let me select it. You can preview the selected part as well. Okay. So all the moving parts are being selected now. And now you have to specify the axis about which the wall disc is going to rotate. So we have two options, axis using cylinder and axis using 2 points. For now, since I have a cylindrical shaft, so I will select the axis using cylinder. So as you can see, we see a dotted line below the around the cylindrical shaft, and this specifies the axis about which the wall is going to rotate. So I click on accept. And now we have to specify the max rated opening of the wall, which is 90 degrees, and create opening conditions. You can create multiple openings as well as single openings, and you can specify the openings in terms of percentages or in terms of degrees. For now, I will specify in degrees, and I want to simulate the walls for starting with 20 degree opening up to 90 degree with increment of 10 degree opening. So it will be 20, 30, 40 and so on up to 90 degrees. I click on add conditions and you can see the wall opening angles. You can also preview the opening. Okay, click on apply settings. Okay, so the first stage of wall geometry is completed, and now we move on to the next stage, which was specifying the flow direction. We in this app, we have developed an innovative logic through which you determine the flow direction. So all we have to need to do is define the inlet pipe and outlet pipe. That's it. Through this we determine the flow directions. So I click on select the inlet pipe, which is upstream pipe, and it is highlighted in the purple color. Selecting outlet pipe, and it is highlighted in the yellow color. Click on apply connection. And that's it. The second stage is completed, and now we can move to running the simulations. So while running the simulations, you have two modes through which you can run. One is the standard resolution and second is the high resolution. The high resolution is an experimental feature which resolves the wall geometry to much more, but it also requires some more time to complete the simulation as well. So, and the standard resolution is fairly accurate as well. So for now, I'll take the standard resolution and submit the simulation. Once I've clicked on it, and there is a pop-up informing me about the number of credits available, as well as the credits required to run this simulation. Since I had selected 8 openings, so the number of credits required are 8. I click on run simulation, and now all the user inputs are completed, and the simulation process is started now on our side. So the whole process will start in the cloud devices, EC2 instances. The job is being submitted, and as you can see, the simulation job has been started running. All the fluid domain status, the mesh status, and the solve as well as the pore status will be updated accordingly. This may take a few more hours to complete, so I have already completed this simulation, and you can also view this simulation in the gallery as well. So we have a number of simulations. So the simulation which we have now started is the triple offset butterfly wall simulation. So when the simulation is completed and all the results are available, we move to the final stage of results. There are some processing tools available to the user to better understand the simulation. So the first interesting one is the performance data, which is a quantitative results of the simulation. And in the performance data, you can see that we offer the data in two parts, as gross values and net values. So the basic difference is that in the net data we subtract the contribution of the pipe. So the pressure drop contribution of the pipe is subtracted from the net total pressure drop. And as such, you can see the various flow coefficient data in detailed results. You can also see the flow rate and the pressure drop, as well as the hydrodynamic torque coefficient values as such. The values are the CDT values are all positive, so the wall is basically resisting the opening operation of the wall. You can also export this result, and also the CV, KV, and CDT graphs are available. You can also view them in a different tab, and if you want to export them as a CSV or as a PNG format, you can export it. Okay. So these are the quantitative results, and now there are also qualitative tools available. First one is the flow animation. Flow animation is basically gives a good visual representation of how the flow is going to happen in through the whole wall. The levers which are visible in the flow lines are going to the velocity and pressure. It may take a moment to load. Okay. Okay. So as you can see in the viewer, the flow lines are visible, and for, let's say, I want to visualize them at opening angle of 60 degree. I click on apply. Okay, so these are the flow lines for 60 degree opening angle. And as you can see, the flow lines give a good visual representation about how the flow is happening. And you can see the weak regions behind the wall body as well. And the flow animations is a very preferred tool for marketing purposes as well. You can see the variable and pressure of variable options in the available. Moving ahead, we have another interesting processing tool that known as the contour plots. So let's add an entry. Okay, let me select a proper visualization plane. I select y equal 50. And yes. So as you can see, these are the contour plots for opening angle of 60 degree. And there is a very good representation of the wake region behind the wall and the stagnation region as well in the front of the wall as well. Contour plots are basically a good representation for analyzing with the various design changes you do in your walls. And moving ahead, all these processing tools and the results from the quantitative are compiled in a very well defined PDF report, which Praveen has explained previously. So let's have a look into it. This is a basically PDF available in a PDF format, and you can download it as well. So the basic structure of the PDF report is about starting with the quantitative values which you are going to get from the simulations. And there are various graphs available as well. And then you have a special compilation of all the data which you have used for the CFD simulation. So you can see the objective of the study, the wall geometry, the CFD analysis methodology, meshing conditions, the fluid volume extraction, the solver part, as well as the fluid properties as well, a definition of boundary conditions, and then the final formulas which have been used in calculating the CV and the KV, as well as the CDT values. And also at the end, we have the velocity as well as the pressure contours. So in all, this procedure only takes a few hours, and we have a complete representation about how the valve is going to perform in a flow loop testing. So you would like to know about how we have the simplicity and as well as the speed through which you can analyze this wall simulation. So now Praveen will tell you more about what the background procedure of the app is, how the processes are happening in the app background. So over to Praveen.
Yes, thanks Prathamesh. Let me share my screen. Okay, thanks Prathamesh for the live demo. And now it's time to explain, tell a story like why we call this app as autonomous. What is the reason behind autonomous? So to understand that, you need to know what is happening behind the scenes of this app. So all the CFD process, the CAD cleanup and fluid volume extraction. So these things are done. It's not just automated, but it does the job autonomously. So when I say autonomous, it's just independent of human interruption or intelligence. So that intelligence is added into the algorithm, which takes the decision depending on the valve CAD model and the issues in the CAD model. So these things are handled on the go by the algorithm. And the decision of mesh sizing and which region of the volume should be refined, and these decisions like how to capture the wake region and the number of prism layers, the first cell height. So all these parameters where in conventional approach, a human brain is required or experience is required. So the app does it flawlessly on the go. So that is the reason why we say it is autonomous. And other than the mesh and CAD cleanup and mesh, during the solving process, the app makes sure the solution is completely converged. So, by monitoring the residual convergence as well as the pressure monitors at inlet to make sure the pressure values which are reported are completely flat. So now it's time to call, shift our vocabulary from behind the scenes to up in the cloud, because everything happens in the cloud. So now you'll be in a better position to understand the whole picture, what happens. So you give the CAD model as an input to the app. It performs or it starts as, dedicated EC2 instance to perform the CFD simulations completely from CAD cleanup to solving. And it uses various simulation of APIs that are developed with those intelligence algorithm. And then once the solution is done, it does post-processing also in the cloud. And then it fetches all the data for the simulation and provides you the simulation result along with the not just the qualitative but also quantitative results. Note, this is not just for one single angle of opening, but it does the same process for each angle of opening. So I mean, let's say you have 10 or 8 different valve openings. So for each angle of opening, it uses a dedicated ECT instance, 36 code machine, and all these processes are performed over there. So which means the results will be available parallelly, all the simulations are running parallelly, and the results will be available at the very, very faster rate. And it is compiled in CVKV CDT curves, and then 3D results and the PDF report. So it's not just one single valve and multiple valve openings. If you have 2-3 designs in mind and would like to test it quickly and come to a conclusion, you know, which one gives a better result, you can do that parallelly. You don't need any, you know, special licenses for parallelizing this parallelization of this process. So it's the same subscription. Whatever you have, and you can run multiple valve simulations, multiple designs. You can completely explore the design space of the valve and then compare the results at once. And it's not just, you know, multiple designs of a single valve. So let's say you are an organization with a multiple research team placed in different or geographical locations, and they're working on different valve products of yours, and they want to use the ABC app. Yes, they can use it without any additional or further extra or hidden costs or any licenses required for especially for this. So the complete process is almost equal to running a single opening condition. You can get the results at the same time. So now when we say autonomous, automated, how reliable are these results? So to make sure we give accurate results, the app is well validated with a number of experimental cases. So here I'm showing you one of such cases for a concentric butterfly valve. The CV and CDT curves are in close agreement with the experimental data, and we have performed almost 7 to 8 more such cases, validation cases, and then fine-tuned our app to take the results closer to the experimental value. So the app is well validated, and we also encourage anyone who is interested to use the app and who would like to validate it with your own lab-tested values for your design. We are welcome. We do support such activities, so you can contact the support. Then we'll be in touch with you for those. And now the last section is the case studies which we have performed using ABC app. So here we have done 3 case studies. One is the effect of the offset or eccentricity of the valve of same size, same valve dia. And then the other one is the flow direction for how a flow direction affects the CDT curve. And the installment, these are just the design of the valve and how the installation of valve drives the CVT. So that is depicted in the case 3. So first case, yes, the concentric butterfly valve, the blue color CVT curve, and the red one is the offset valve of same size. So you can see the design or the eccentricity can include completely change the course of CDT curve, and there the offset valve has a torque reversal point and it goes negative, so the CDT goes negative. So this is the characteristic of these butterfly valves. And let's take this offset valve and let's try to change the flow direction and see what are its effect. So again, for the same offset valve, if I change the flow direction such that the shaft side is facing the upstream of flow, then again the same design shifts its CDT curve to a different nature. And here 3 cases are compared. In case 3, 3 configurations are compared, as you can see here. So how the valve stem is oriented with respect to the elbow bend. So the valve is placed right after the elbow. So we are trying 3 different configurations. So in the first configuration, the valve is rotated in the clockwise direction, and here the blue curve is the corresponding CDT curve, Here you can see even at fully opening and opened angle, which you know, which is a concentric butterfly valve, still you have a high torque value at the 90 degree opening. So this is where the asymmetric velocity profile upstream creates a problem for this create load for the actuator even at higher angle of opening. And moving to configuration 2 with the same valve and same location, same orientation, just if I start rotating the valve in an anti-clockwise or counterclockwise direction, then the complete nature of the curve starts to behave like an offset valve. So there is a torque reversal and then it goes on the negative side. So now the valve manufacturer's recommended installation, which is the orientation which you're seeing, the stem vertical is, you know, it's perpendicular or it's in line with the elbow. So here the curve starts to behave exactly like a typical concentric butterfly valve. So these are the impact of, you know, how the installation, you know, drives the ECDT curve. So all the curves in one single graph for your comparison. And these are the upcoming features we have planned for launch in coming months. So we have incipient cavitation feature and operating flow conditions, not just the lab conditions, you can simulate it for operating flow conditions with any fluid property you would like to simulate it for. And the most important relevant one for this today's webinar is torque calculator. So CFD simulation will provide you dynamic torque and few analytical calculations are performed by the calculator to calculate the braking and packing torque, and with few user inputs we can calculate seating torque. Collectively we can provide you the complete total torque curve, total closing and opening, which will be useful to size your actuator. So this is the exciting feature. And not just that, we also in simulation of team is capable and or supporting taking other consultancy project for advanced valve simulations which are not currently supported in the app, like the cavitation noise, a slurry flow. So all this type of like advanced simulations, we take it as on a consultancy basis. So if you have any query, you can feel free to contact us and we'll be more than happy to help you in contributing for the valve design. And here we have showcased one of the R&D work which we are doing, and this is available for you know, public access to try out. So what we have done is, this is a machine learning algorithm or artificial intelligence has been used to produce this app. What it does is you just play with the design, different design parameters of a valve, and the app produces this CV curve instantly. So the machine learning algorithm requires a lot of data. So all those data has been developed and through CFD simulations and through this AVC app. And not just this, it can help you in the reverse problem as well. If you want to, you have a target CV curve in mind, just adjust these data points and design a CV curve, and the app will back calculate and provide you with more options about, you know, what combinations of design parameters would help you to reach that curve. So that's it. So the session is open for Q&A. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask in the chat box. Pratamesh, you have any questions in the chat box listed up?
Yes, one of our user is asking that is there any dependency of the wall size on the simulation time and such? So we would like
Yes. So there is no specific dependency of time or anything, like, you know, cost or time depending on the valve size. It's same. So it uses the same similar machines and everything. So the time and cost difference, there is no cost difference. Absolutely, the time difference could be because of the mesh size and those things, but it's very negligible, almost same.
Yes, There is another question about the security of the CAD model which has been uploaded. So let me answer that question. We do not use any third-party services in our app, and we only use the AWS Amazon services. And this is a very secure platform, and it is a security level of nearly the bank-grade securities. And even if the user uploads the geometry, we do not have any access to it. And only the access is granted by the user, then only we can access in case of any failure issues which you want to solve. So the app is pretty secure and there is no threat to the wall CAD as such.
Yes, Prathamesh, I would like to add a few more points about the security issues. So we also have an option of enterprise subscription where you get your separate domain where only the employees of your organization will get access, and you can add two-factor authentication and geofencing of such things so that, you know, make it more secure. So this option is available. Yes, Prathamesh.
Okay, one of our user is asking that how do I calculate torque values other than the pressure values?
Okay, so the once you get the CDT values, so you know the pressure drop for your case, operating case, and using that you can back calculate the dynamic torque required. See the dynamic, I'll just go to that particular slide which talks about. Okay, so what the app provides is the CDT value, and what you know is the pressure drop for your case, and you know the valve size, so you can calculate the dynamic torque. So that's it. So
yes, that's it from our side, and we'll be more than happy if you have any further queries, and you may contact us an email as well. So that's it from our side, and it was a pleasure hosting for this you for this webinar.
And so I just have one more slide. I'll just this is a frequently asked question, so I thought I will straight away show it to you. So what are the different subscription plans we have? So we have a 15-day trial so that you get comfortable and understand and explore, you know, how our app can add value to your product. And once you're convinced, then we have three options for you: the individual plan, business plan, and enterprise plan. So individual plan has it's a monthly subscription, and the business and enterprise are a yearly subscription with limited, you know, different cloud credits. So $500, $5,000, and $20,000 are the price range for individual, business, and enterprise. So each has a limitations on the number of users, but not the number of simulations you do. So it depends on the cloud credits only. So there is no constraint as that, but for comfortable collaboration of design collaboration and project collaboration, you might we might suggest you to go for enterprise, where you have unlimited users and a separate portal where you can manage the cloud credits and who has the rights for simulating the product. So such benefits are there for enterprise subscription. So that's it. And if you have any specific requirement about, you want to validate your own experimental data, what you have, then feel free to contact us. We support that tasks as well. So yes, Prathamesh.
So another thing I would like to add is that what we perform for our new users, what we call as a trust building activity, where we conduct validation studies for customer wall designs. So these validation studies are free of cost, and we provide the best possible solutions for it as well. And we recommend users to, if in case you are trying some new designs in as well, we can conduct a validation study for that part as well. Okay. Okay, so that's all from our side, I think, Praveen.
Yes, and if you have any other questions, please feel free to mail us, and we'll be happy to connect with you and answer your queries and help you in designing your app.
So another thing I would like to add is that we perform for our new users what you call as a trust building activity, where we conduct validation studies for customer wall designs. So these validation studies are free of cost, and we provide the best possible solutions for it as well. And we recommend users to, if in case you are trying some new designs as well, we can conduct a validation study for that part as well. Thank you all for attending this webinar, and it was a pleasure to host it.
Thank you.
Good day.